In this camp in Idlib province, the mud is thick. The morning walk to get water is through what seem like permanent puddles. Life here is defined by the mud. It's where boys will be boys, and where little girls in flip-flops try not to slip, hanging on to tents that have become their homes. They are the displaced families who fled to Idlib because it was the last place to flee to. The displaced children who've seen things no adult should ever have to see. This is Ahlam.
We were displaced to this camp because of the airstrikes and the missiles. There's too much mud. There's no school. In my village, I used to play with my friends at school. My friends were killed in an airstrike, and I survived, then came here.
In this camp, children become caregivers, and they heat their hands on a blackened outdoor tea kettle. This family has been living here since May.
It is very difficult to walk because of the mud. The tent does not weather the cold or the storms. We don't have proper stoves for heating, and as you see, the conditions are terrible. My children are always sick because of the cold.
Nearby, this woman tells us she fled her home as it was bombed in the middle of the night.
It is too much cold and mud here. I'm getting sick all the time. I pray that we won't be flooded because of the rain. My fear is that we will get flooded and drown. I hope that I won't drown and die in the flood.
I've been going to Syria multiple times in the past 7-8 years. This is the worst I've seen. In terms of the inability of the international community to accommodate to the needs of the displaced.
Zahir Salul is a doctor in Chicago who regularly returns to his native Syria to help. These scenes were all filmed by him. The Kafr Yamul camp has more than doubled in population in the last 6 months because Russian and Syrian jets followed refugees to Idlib. There's supposed to be a ceasefire, but the airstrikes are relentless. In December alone, at least 65 children were killed or injured. And they're trapped between the regime in Russia from the south and the closed Turkish border in the north. Hundreds of thousands are settling close to that border, but Turkey already has 4 million refugees, and its doors are locked, says Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan.
This ceasefire must be conducted in a way to prevent 400,000 people from reaching our borders.
And for those people still in Idlib, they need to survive both the airstrikes and illness. In the camp, Salul treated whomever he could.
Everyone had some respiratory issues. Some of them had asthma, some of them had infections, some of them had pneumonia. Of course, everyone had psychological trauma because of the recent displacement.
Many families have been forced to flee the airstrikes multiple times. A local humanitarian group set up tents under a stadium's grandstand. And in a nearby former school, children with American superhero backpacks walk where the walls are full of holes and where outside the windows, playgrounds have long been abandoned.
Every deserted building, every old school, every mosque were converted to temporary shelters. It was very cold in the building. There was this old piano that the children were trying to play with, but it was seen like you are in a horror movie.
1,000 miles away in northeast Syria, the map is very different. The American footprint has shrunk from 1,000 to about 500. They're deployed with the mostly Kurdish Syrian Democratic Forces. But since Turkey's incursion in October, things have become more complicated.
You have this casserole of flags. Within several hours driving, we saw a Syrian regime-flagged vehicle, we saw a Russian-flagged vehicle, and then we saw a U.S. convoy.
Gail Tamak-Limon is a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations and visited the region just before Christmas, her 8th visit in the last few years. She says there's a tenuous stability kept by the mostly Kurdish SDF.
It is a remarkable testament to the ability of the SDF, who fought ISIS alongside the Americans, to keep in place a very fragile, pretty endangered, but still very real governance structure, keeping a level of security and stability in place.
But the SDF is distracted from their fight against ISIS by the incursion of Turkish forces who consider them terrorists and a displacement crisis.
If the forces who are fighting ISIS now also have to defend themselves and to deal with roughly 200,000 or so who were estimated to have been displaced by the incursion, you can imagine that the fight against the Islamic State doesn't become secondary, but it is competing with survival in terms of priorities for these folks.
Lamon met with SDF Commander Mazlum Kobani, who spends much of his time negotiating with the multiple militaries deployed to Syria.
So far, it looks like a lot of deconfliction and a lot of discussion with Russia. There's a lot of conversation going on. I think that Mazlum no longer has illusions that the Americans are going to protect the Syrian Kurds or their gains, but he does ask that the Americans stay, right? He was very clear in our conversation, until a political process is in place.
But that political process is stalled. And so Idlib's displaced children spend every night around the campfire. Salul is with them, trying to find light in darkness.
We have children of this camp who've been here for about a year or so, and they're all beautiful and cute.
They sing a song called My Homeland about survival and happiness. And this is where, in their innocence, these children find resilience. To draw pictures, they use the mud that defines their camp. They use mud to leave their handprints and turn their hardship into hope.
Most of the children adapt to the situation very quickly, and they laugh, they smile, they play, they sing, they dream of future.
But they still live in Syria, where most of those dreams are nightmares. And while the adults try to distract the children with shadow boxes, the monsters here are all too real.